Okay, so this is not correct. So let me. I want some general. To discuss some general philosophy. And look in our case. So general philosophy is the following. Where this derived categories appear in general. So you have some X, consider some geometric structure. And then we want to study it, so standard way to study is standard idea, standard linearize. If you want to study something, you should study some linear thing. So now what does it mean? So it might mean different things. For instance, you can assign to these things some vector space. But let's consider situation when I assign to it to X, you assign some abelian category. Okay, and I want to consider example. I considered it already on Thursday, but let's do it. For instance, suppose that X is manifold. And you would like to study its topological structure, homotopy structure, by considering A is a category of local systems. We fix some field K, fix a field K. K, and consider local systems on X. So this is abelian, nice abelian category. But now, the idea is that this, very often, this is not good enough, not big enough. For example, if X is connected, simply connected, then this thing will be equivalent to the category of vector spaces. So it doesn't somehow preserve some information about X. Now the next idea is that, in fact, you can preserve some information. Namely, you embed this category A to some larger category B. And then you consider derived category D A B. So this category, so we will discuss today in more detail. This category, derived category of B models, which cohomologies are all in A. So the claim is that this category already remembers much more information. For example, if you consider in our case this space, and if you consider, for instance, home Cx, so constant local system to Cx shifted by I, then this will be Hi of X. So hence, from category A, you cannot recover any information about X, practically any information. But when you extend this category to this larger category, you'll see that it's, so A will contain this full subcategory of this. Then we reconstruct essentially homotopy type of X in this case. So this is some general thing. So once more, this is a general idea that if you consider some geometric structure, you want to linearize it to consider general idea, to consider abelian category. I claim that, in fact, what one should do is consider slightly more precise thing, namely some abelian category, which is embedded into some trend-related category. Now, category B here, we cannot reconstruct, and it's not uniquely defined. It's, in some sense, not interesting. Category B is some kind of large category. So in our case, this category B is just category of all sheaves on X. So this category is very large. It is, we don't want to reconstruct it because, for instance, we want to understand X only homotopy types of X. So category of sheaves is just not defined. Category of local systems is defined. Okay, so this is some general general ideology that I discuss it more detail, but I call it provisionally that A is an enhanced abelian category. So it's abelian category with some additional structure, which is okay, so we'll discuss it. Which
yeah. If K is a cube, then this category remembers all the rational homotopy type of X. That's what he said.
Oh. Might be. I don't know. No.
So it just wasn't a precise statement.
No. It wasn't a precise statement. No. Just the idea is that if X is simply connected, then in some sense, cohomology of X to a large extent the same as the homotopy type. It's not quite the same, but so cohomology we can recover. Okay, I don't know whether we can recover here. This. Okay, so next thing which I want to say is that what is some general thing about this construction. So we have, I would like to discuss this general construction. So I have category A and B. So B is large abelian category and A is some small abelian subcategory. Then what I can do, I can consider complexes AB. So these are complexes of B models which cohomologous lie in A. A is some full subcategory, with nice properties. And then, okay, then again, the ideology which already was discussed, we are interested in fact in this complex, we are interested only in the cohomologous. Now, what does it mean? So if we are interested only in cohomologous, we cannot just say that two complexes are equivalent if they have the same cohomology, because this from the categorical point of view, this is a meaningless statement. What we can say is that if you have morphism of two things, if it is quasi-isomorphism, we should consider them to be equivalent. So it means that we have some collection of morphisms, which weak equivalents, which is just, in this case, quasi-isomorphisms. Isomorphisms. And now what we want to do, we want to consider complexes and consider invert this quasi-isomorphism. So we would like to consider this kind of object. And here I should say that there are two ways to do it. There is a way which is accessible now, and there is a way which was 50, 60 years ago, 60, 50, okay. So the way, correct way probably to do it is to consider that this is, you can consider this as using Dwyer Kahn construction. You can interpret this W minus 1 B as simplicially enriched category, enriched category, which is essentially the same as infinity category. And this language, which was developed last problems. No, все-таки, yes, which allows to do this. The problem is, so I call it high road. This is correct approach. Unfortunately, the problem is that I don't know it. I don't know quite enough infinity categories to do this, and I hope from Volodya's lectures to be able to phrase this language. So 50 years ago, this was completely inaccessible. And what Verdier did, he considered W minus one of this thing as actual category. Plus some additional structure. So as I understand, this category will be nothing more and nothing less, it's just homotopy category of this infinity category. And it's known that the homotopy category is not a very good thing. For example, if you have morphism in the homotopy category, you cannot form its cone. If you have morphism of topological spaces, you can define well-defined cone, which will be topological space, at least in the homotopy category, it will be well-defined. But if you have morphism in the homotopy category, then there's no canonical construction of cone. So this category is not, what, so this is called derived category, DAFP. And so I will say in a moment what, how to think about this, how is there thought about this. It is not very good thing, but for 50 years, it allowed to do something, at least. So why it is not very good thing? No, for example, if you consider, for instance, shifts on some space, if you know shift locally, then you know it globally. But if you know element of the derived category of shifts locally, then you cannot construct it. It doesn't find globally. So this is kind of problems which you have. So each time, for example, it's very typical, you would like to construct some new object, some new shift. We can construct it locally by some explicit construction. Then we say that shift, since we construct it locally, it automatically defines global construction. If you do the same with element in the derived category, it doesn't help you. Each time, what if you nevertheless want to do this construction, you actually go back to actual complex of shifts, work hard, and show that such construction exists. It takes a lot of work each time. So I hope that in infinity categories, it's all automatic. Already, is it? In infinity categories? Even? Okay. I hope so. Okay, so now, so let me tell what Verdier did. So he defines this category with some additional structure, and he calls this triangulated category. So again, this is philosophically very important thing that it was again realized, I think, maybe the last 50 years, that if you have some construction, some object, then it's very important to understand if you have two constructions, that they give the same answer. Whether two such things are equivalent or not. And so the idea is that what Verdier did, it was quite untrivial, that he embedded all these derived categories into some thing, namely in the realm of triangulated categories. So he could say that two completely different derived categories are equivalent. Or not equivalent. So this is some meaningful statement. So let me, I talked a little bit, but let me remind, so what is triangulated category? Again, I don't want to give precise definition, but let's think with category. So D is first of all additive category. Second, you have T's automorphism after functor invertible. And the third, you have collection tau of exact triangles. The exact triangle is a collection of morphisms x, y, z, tx, so here alpha, beta, gamma, t gamma, ty, and so on. So this exact triangle, or distinguished triangle, it's the same thing. And this satisfies some axioms, so I don't want to list all the axioms. Again, with here list some kind of minimal axioms, but I want to list to explain some important things which here show that they satisfy. So important thing is that first of all that if you have x to y morphism, then it can be extended any gamma x to y can be extended to triangle, extended to a triangle uniquely up to non-canonical isomorphism. So in this not canonicity is bad feature of this. Okay, and so this thing is called, Z is called cone of this gamma. For any morphism, you can define cone, which is defined uniquely up to isomorphism, but this isomorphism is not unique in principle. Now, so and this is so say same factorial that if you have morphism x to y to x prime to y prime, then you can extend it to morphism to z to z prime. So given this, you can construct this morphism. Again, not unique here. Now, important. I don't remember Vizier's axioms, but the most important corollary of this axiom is the following, this exact long exact sequence. Long exact sequence. So this we'll use all the time, that if you have exact triangle, x, y, z, tx, and so on, and you have any object W, then if you consider home W, X, this will be just abelian group into home W, Y, home W, Z, home W, TX, and so on. This will be long exact sequence. So once more, Vizier doesn't phrase it as a axiom, he deduces this from some simple axioms, but that's really what we are going to use. So this is analogous if you have any, for any R, you consider in opposite direction, home ZR maps to home YR, and so on, home XR is also
can you please don't write after your
question? Okay. Also is an exact sequence. Okay, so this is the most important axioms. And also there is one technical axiom, which is very important, but it's called octoid, octahedral axiom. So let me, it always, okay, it usually presents some difficulty because it's not clear what where it comes from, and I want to explain that it comes from some very simple thing. Namely, suppose I have two complexes, just in the category of complexes, suppose I have two complex set morphism, B into C, then as we have seen, you can always assume that this morphism is an embedding. And then con will be just A is equal to just C mod B. Okay, so now suppose that you have also some complex A inside B. Then what you can do, you can consider C prime. I will not write dots here. I can consider B prime, which is B mod C, B mod A. I can consider C prime, which is C mod A. And now B prime is embedded to C prime. And I can consider quotient con of this, which is just R prime, which is C prime on B prime. And then in the very first course on group theory, there is a theorem that in fact R prime is canonically isomorphic to R. Okay, so if you now write all this down, then you'll get this collection. So you have on one hand, okay, so you have R prime, C prime, B prime, R prime, this exact triangle, C prime. Here you have B, C, A. Here you have B, A. This exact triangle, this identity. And now we have B, C, A. This exact triangle, and this is this is isomorphic. And if you write down, you'll get exactly this octahedral axiom. So this octahedral axiom is nothing else as this isomorphism, R is isomorphic to R prime, which has a name even, it's called isomorphism theorem. But it's somehow trivial. Okay, so Pansov, what Verdier did, he defined the notion of derived category. So he defined the derived category for any abelian category, but we see that the interesting thing is always category of this type. We can consider somehow partial derived category. And if he considers it as a triangulated category, namely it's additive category, T is just shift, and exact triangle is by definition image of short exact sequence. Of complexes. So, okay, so these are triangulated categories. Now there is some additional structure. Here our category DAB has additional structure, namely, category A is embedded here in natural way, namely just we can see the complexes which are in degree zero and yes, complexes in degree zero and then it gives morphism from A into here and inverse morphism is given by cohomologies. So if so A goes to complex 0, 0 so M 0, 0 and inverse morphism is that complex C goes to H 0 so and this identifies A as a subcategory in this triangulated category. Okay, so I would like to write this down a little bit more precisely, because this will be important later. Namely, I would like to describe this functor in the following way that so suppose I have a complex C, which is complex C naught, C one, C minus one, and so on. So what I want to do, I want to define some operation tau less than zero of C. This will be some complex which has the following property that hi of this complex, which be the same as hi of C when I is less than zero, and hi of this complex will be zero if I is more equal to zero. So, and the description of this complex is the following. C less than zero of C dot is the following complex. So I want to preserve, so it is C minus two and C minus one. And here I take, instead of C zero, I take just image. Just, so I want just all cohomologies are the same. I have written it always. A kernel of T. And then zero.
This thing has cohomology zero. This thing has cohomology zero. What is going to equal zero? What do we have?
What the?
This has cohomology zero.
So less.
This is more than or equal to zero.
Okay, so less or equal to zero. Okay. So this complex is, so this operation is just on the level of complexes. So it is embedded into C check, into C. Just a moment, I see that I wrote. Okay, so, yes, this is less or equal to zero. Excuse me, this is tau less or equal to zero. Okay, so this is embedded, and I can consider quotient. So C mod tau less than less or equal to zero of C, which you can easily write down. It will be some explicit complex. And cohomology of this complex, so this complex will be tau more equal to zero, more than zero of C. So its cohomologies will be zero, all negative degree and zero, and will be the same as cohomology of C in higher dimensions. Okay, so you, and then this, for instance, this functor H naught of C is in fact nothing. Okay, so maybe I'll tell. So the idea is that in fact there are two functors right here. So this is one functor which I described, but I can, so I have tau less or equal zero, C is maps into C. And, but I can consider another functor, tau tilde less or equal to zero of C, which is constructed in the following way. It is almost the same, C minus one, C minus. And then you consider C naught, and then you consider image of differential z zero. So the idea is that this complex, you have canonical morphism from C into this complex. This complex, so this complex was subcomplex of C. And this complex is quotient complex of C.
Do you map C1 into the image of P?
What?
How do I map C1 into the image of P?
So just this for a moment.
I think it is quasi-isomorphic to the previous complex.
Yes, yes. No, important thing is, first of all, that it's quasi-isomorphic. Just for a moment. So you have... Ah, no, no, I'm not correct. So this
you
also...
You probably wanted to write down, instead of image, the quotient of C0 by the image.
I want here cohomology to be equal to zero. That's first of all, so I write image of T. And cohomology here will be the same as before. Okay, so then what you have is, I'm not correct. So you have, still you have morphism of this into, embedding into C. So this thing embeds into C. And the important thing is that these two operations, they are quasi-isomorphic. In the derived category, this is an isomorphism. So you construct, so the idea is that you would like in the derived category to construct tau less or equal to zero. The claim is that on the level of complexes, you can do it in two, there are two things which, two absolutely explicit constructions which give you the same thing, which are different. One of them is mapped to another, it's quasi-isomorphism for obvious reason, but constructions are different. Okay, so what I wanted to say is that it turns out that it's better to describe this. So we describe this category A as a subcategory of triangulated category, but so using this cohomological factor. But so the problem is that this functor here to here and here to here doesn't have right and left adjoint, but doesn't have nice adjointness properties, so it's difficult to understand. And it turns out that it can be written as a composition of functors which have adjointness properties. Namely, let's consider D more equal to zero, AB, which just consists of complexes. Complexes such that HI complexes C, such that HI of C is equal to zero for I less than zero. so that you have natural embedding D more equal to zero. It's full subcategory of D. And the claim is that this functor has adjoint functor, which I don't remember from which side, as usual. And this functor is nothing else than truncation, which we described. So the claim is that if you consider this functor, then there exists adjoint functor, and it will be just truncation, which I described. So similarly, you can define D less or equal to zero of B. D of B, it's in embedding categories, and it has adjoint functor from opposite side, which is tau more equal to what? Tau more than zero. Or tau more equals to one.
Which is equal to the two? Because you're given two functors that
They're the same in the category, of course, that's important.
Joseph, I have a question.
Yes.
Is this not just a joint to H0 from one side?
No.
H0,
mm-hmm. It's a composition of left adjoint and right. Yes, this composition of left adjoint and right. So the claim is that functor H0 is just composition of tau. Less or equal to zero and tau more equal to zero. So the claim is that it's better to think about this functor as composition. Also you can write, of course, it's tau more equal to zero and tau less or equal to zero. It's better to decompose it in this way because these functors, they have adjoint factors, so it's easier to understand them. Yes, of course. So you are correct. I want to say it, but so the idea is that when I consider this functor, so I should be more careful. So you have there are many functors. So you have this. Okay, let's consider some of them. So T less or equal to zero. So it is first of all it is embedded into D. Here you have. And this is fully faithful embedding. And then you have adjoint functor, which I can consider D less or equal to zero. So I can consider it as functor here, or can consider it and then embed back here. Only if I do this, only after this I can apply the second factor. As usual, there is some not very correct, but standard things that if one thing is, one space is subspace of others, then everything which goes on this space, we somehow consider. We should consider it as a bigger space, but we just use notation that it's in smaller space. So correct thing is that you have this functor. So this functor is, in fact, composition. Tau less or equal to zero is, in fact, composition of these two. But since it's subcategory, somehow we can use notations here. Okay, so important thing is that this will be, this kind of structure we'll see later. Probably today. Okay, so now let's come back to our thing. So we considered case when X is algebraic variety of C, and we consider category B is shifts. Set X analytic. X analytic is the usual topological space which is obtained from C point of X. And A is constructible shifts on X analytic. This notion of constructible shifts depends on algebraic structure of X. And so we decided that correct, so to say, object to study is this, and here's subcategory A. So this is triangulated category, and this is abelian category. And it's good object, for example, because you have many functors. If you have morphism from X to Y, you can define morphisms on these derived categories, and so on. Now, as I explained, category B is, in some sense, not very essential. You cannot reconstruct it from this thing. It is. So one can see examples when you have the same different categories B, which give you the same pair. So important thing is only pair abelian category and triangulated category here. And what's category B is, in some sense, it's a technical question to choose correct category B. So we constructed everything. And then, so this was situation until somehow beginning of 1980s, but it was realized that this is some better picture. And it was realized from some completely different thing, from theory of Z models. So I'd like to Pedley was developed the theory of Z models. It's purely algebraic theory. So again, X is algebraic variety over C. Then we can consider some dx. Well, suppose it is non-singular. I don't want to consider dx. You can consider modules of dx, category of quasi-cogent models of dx, purely algebraic theory. And it turns out that there you can find some small subcategory, rs of dx, some nice small subcategory. And you can consider the derived category. Yes. And again, there are these functors, pi star, pi schrieg, pi star, pi schrieg, d. All these functors you can define. And then one can show the theorem, so this Riemann, Hilbert Riemann correspondence. Riemann correspondence, this proof by Kashiwara. The idea that not only proof by Kashiwara, but somehow envisioned by Kashiwara. He somehow realized that something like this should be true. And then proved it by pretty hard analysis. Namely, the theorem is following. Yes.
What is M? What is dx? What is M and what is RS?
No. Okay. Okay, let me repeat once more. Dx is shift of differential operators on X. Suppose X is non-singular, it's purely algebraic C, you can define what the differential operators. M is my general notation. M is category of modules. M modules of dx. No. In this case, these are category of quasi-cogent dx models. Yes. No, since I'm not going to use this, I'm giving. Now, the claim is that this category contains some small subcategory, which is very important, which is not easy to define. So there was a course here last year defined that it's, but one can define it.
Galanomic
regular singular. So it's more, you can define galanomic, it's half of the way, and then you consider regular singular, it's another half. just and then you can consider this derived category, and this derived category you can define all the functors this, in completely different way, but they will have exactly the same properties as what we considered before. And then the theorem, Riemann-Hilbert correspondence, is the following. Theorem. Suppose k is equal to c. Our field of coefficients is equal to c. Then there exists a canonical equivalence. I usually denote it omega, which is given by some explicit construction from drs of dx into deconstructible of x. So starting from any complex of dx models, you construct some complex of dx models with which cohomology is a regular singular, you construct some complex of sheaves, which is constructible in the sense which I described. And the non-trivial thing is that it's equivalence of categories. Moreover, this equivalence of categories is compatible with all functors. Okay, so now I'm not going to discuss neither definition nor the proof of this theorem, but I just want to think aloud about this statement. So first of all, this general idea is that you have two triangulated categories which are equivalent. Then general philosophy very often is that this means that there exists just one category, and so there are two mirrors of this category, just two causal systems in some sense of this category, two descriptions of this category. This category is just the same. And I think that this is a very useful point of view, that we have, in fact, the algebraic variety, you can assign some category. And it has two images. You can think about this as category of constructible sheaves. In analytic topology, we can consider purely algebraic realization as regular singular.
So this kind of only for the complex case, yes?
Yes, so I especially say that when k is equal to c. Because these are in, so this is equivalence of categories of c over c. All these categories are c linear. Okay.
This is in the
Zariski topology
or analytic topology?
Where? Here, this pure algebraic construction. Zariski topology doesn't know anything about analytic topology. So, in other words, when I say algebraic construction, it means that it's defined over any algebraically closed field. So, but now the idea is that in each of these categories, you have some abelian subcategories. So this category is just the same category. But now, when you look at, from this point of view, you have here a subcategory. So see, A is equal to constructible sheaves on X. It's a nice abelian category, which for us is somehow geometric kernel of this. So something which we can describe, something which. But here it is something different. It's RS and it turns out that this functor doesn't map this thing to this one. More precisely, on some piece of it, it does. So if you consider, for instance, here smooth smooth the models, then this will go to some local systems. But if you have constructible things, then it doesn't move. So hence we have the following situation. We have some category, D is triangulated category. degree. And we found here two subcategories, A and A prime, two abelian subcategories, which play somehow very similar role, but they are different. And if they are different, then you can ask the question, which is better? And then, by all means, this category is much better than this one. Namely, for instance, this category, every object has finite lengths. In this category, that's just not true. It just, if you consider just on the line, you can see the constant shift, then you can chip from it point by point, you can consider subshifts, smaller and smaller subshifts. So that also this category is invariant with respect to Vizier duality, and this is not. So the idea is that this category, and also we'll see other examples, we show that this category is correct one and this is not correct one. So this was somehow some surprising discovery that so when you consider category D, A, B, then somehow B is not very relevant, it should be sufficiently large. So, but it seems that A is important category. But it turned out that it's not quite correct, that there is better category of the same type. Now, there is one, yes.
You said the constructible shifts aren't preserved by Verdier duality.
Yes.
But before you said that this equivalence respects the Verdier duality.
Yes, sure.
But how do you find Verdier duality on the category on the right, okay, right-hand side if it doesn't preserve the constructible shifts?
On the left hand side?
On the right hand side. On the right hand side, you consider complexes of vector spaces which have constructible cohomology.
Yes, it's not. No, we discuss. No, I formulate this theorem. This is that Vizier duality maps such complex into such complex.
It doesn't necessarily map that.
Yes, but if you have this constructible shift, is Vizier dual will have constructible cohomologies, but will not be constructed. It will be not a shift, will complex, usually, except some special cases. Okay, so now the idea, so informal statement is that this category is much more correct than this one. It has only one bad feature. Namely, it's very difficult to describe it. Namely, some McPherson and some students of his try to describe it directly. So you have algebraic variety. You would like to construct some abelian category to attach to this variety. And they were not able to do it. So the only way to construct it is that you first construct constructible shifts and construct derived category and then specify this thing, which we'll discuss how, in this derived category. So you can describe, so here the image of this category here is called perverse shifts. So this will perverse shifts. So in this category, so the claim is that this, so now, this was just some kind of motivation. Maybe I will write it down. So this was a motivation for the following statement that you have category deconstructible of shifts on X. So D of X. And here you have subcategory of constructible shifts. And also, the claim is that here you have another category which is called, another abelian category which is called perverse shifts on X. And that's what we are going to discuss, which is the center of this course. So there exists some abelian subcategory here, which is in some sense similar to this category, but is much better. So the only thing for which it is not better is that it's difficult to describe. So for instance, I think up to now there's no, so to say, direct description of this abelian category. So the only description is what I described. You construct, consider category constructible shifts, you embed it into this category of constructible complexes, and then